Hi, it's Dwyer, gamblersadvisory.com, dwyervip.com. Remember, the opinion you should follow should be your own. Just consider this video to be a second opinion from a complete stranger online. Now, it's early in the morning on January the 29th here in Northern California. The sun is up. It's not quite yet 7:30. Let's roll into some gambling. Australian Open. Right now, people at dwyervip.com know that my recommended play before this tournament happened was to take Novak Djokovic on a futures to win it and to also take Roger Federer on a futures. You actually got 7-1 on Federer. Well, of course, those two guys ended up meeting in the semifinals. Djokovic is the man standing. He's not going up against Andy Murray. Now, to me, this is a perfect opportunity to not take a side, but just to try to take advantage of some ambitious odds that the casino's giving you, right? You don't have to take a side here if you don't believe that this match is going to end in straight sets, right? I know Murray was just tested. I know that match went a long way. Right? But I feel that Djokovic and Murray have enough time to recuperate, to revive themselves before the finals, and I think these two are close, right? I know Djokovic is the guy on top here, but understand Murray has beaten him on a hard court within the last 18 months. So I'm not expecting this to end in straight sets. So the play I'm recommending is that you engage in set betting here and exclude the three-set option. In other words, you can take every scenario other than straight sets, and you can actually profit if any of it happens. And, of course, if certain outcomes happen, you profit big time. So the bets I'm recommending, it's a bet portfolio, are the non-straight set betting options, right? They're listed at dwyervip.com. It's Djokovic to win in four sets. You're getting a plus 250. Djokovic to win in five sets. You're getting a plus 650. Murray to win in four sets. You're getting a plus 1,000. That's 10-1, folks. And Murray to win in five sets, you're getting a plus 900, right? That's 9-1. So understand, if this goes to the fifth set, you're looking at least hitting on a plus 650, right? And if it ends in four sets, if Djokovic wins, you win a plus 250, right? Play with the numbers. You don't have to put the same amount on every option. What you want to do is try to equalize the payouts, right? So give that a look. Let's talk about a boxing match where I recommended the underdog, Amir Manzoor, against Dominique Brazil. This was the undercard to the Danny Garcia, Robert the Ghost Guerrero fight. I picked Garcia in that one. But the heavyweight match really fascinated me. Now, I said that Manzoor was a live underdog, right? I also recommended that folks, you know, take both guys to win by KO. I thought if I had one bet to make, it would have been on Manzoor, right? But I also said take both to win by KO, right? Because I didn't see the fight going the distance. Well, you know the rest. The underdog was a live dog. Manzoor knocks down Brazil, who's badly hurt. And Manzoor had 2 minutes left in the round to close the show and could not do it. Right? Could not do it. So, of course, Brazil then is able to get Manzoor out of there. The fight, of course, never makes it to the second half of the fight. So if you took both guys by KO, you did well because the KO happened. Even though Manzoor was going the distance in recent fights, this fight wasn't going to go the distance. Sadly, we weren't able to completely KO the casino. The casino beat us on the Amir Manzur to win prop. Let's just say the underdog bit, right? He did get the knockdown. He just could not finish the fight. Let's talk about a big fight coming up in the light heavyweight division. You know, I personally consider the odds being posted on this Jean Pascal Sergey Kovalev fight, where Pascal is a plus 950, right? 9.5 to 1 to lose the fight. In other words, how do you put it? What the casino's telling you is that if these guys fought 10 and a half times, that Pascal would only win one of the 10 and a half matches, right? That's ridiculous. I'm not saying Pascal wins this fight. What I'm saying, though, is these odds are ridiculous. There comes a time where, when you're at the casino and you see a plus 950, you have to say this is a mispriced fight. Now, John David Jackson, the trainer of Kovalev, right, feels that and has said so. Pascal is a shot fighter, right? The argument is that Pascal didn't look good against the Cuban guy that he fought right before he fought Kovalev. And then Kovalev came in and Kovalev pressed the issue and Kovalev got the KO, right? Now, I'm one of those, and I said so in the post-fight video, who thought that that fight was stopped prematurely. Right? I'm just here to tell you that Pascal is one of the better athletes at light heavy. I still believe to this day, although you, YouTube Nation, on a whole disagree with me, Pascal is one of the hardest punchers in boxing. Right? Pascal has hand speed. Pascal has it all together. Right? Pascal that night didn't have the right strategy. He's too in front of Kovalev, who, let's get real, the boxing public has been overvaluing, right? Blake Caparillo dropped Kovalev. Understand, Kovalev was down against Darnell Boone, right? We can talk about the Hopkins fight, right? Hopkins was almost 50 years old. Hopkins went the distance with Kovalev. You look at some Kovalev fights, and quite frankly, you know, Kovalev's getting hit in matches. Folks know what he's doing. Now, that's not to say that he isn't a champion. Understand, I've taken Kovalev here in some big fights. The Nathan Cleverley fight, for example, right? I applaud Kovalev for the courage, the boldness. He fights Cleverley in the UK, right? He fights Pascal in Canada. Right, Kovalev is legit, make no mistake about it. But we're all mortals. Right, Kovalev has looked very mortal in the ring at times. Right, the Blake Caparillo fight, folks, he gets hit flush. Right, he goes down. That's not a slip. Right, he's not talking to the referee distracted. No, he's looking at the guy and he gets hit and he gets dropped. Now, I'm just here to tell you that Jean Pascal has a lot more talent than that guy. A lot more, right? So now Pascal is working with Freddie Roach. Now we know, no one knows this better than Pascal, who already fought the man. We know Kovalev is going to be aggressive. He's going to throw a lot of punches. Sooner or later, while he picks his spots, he's going to come to you, right? That's not a secret. Kovalev is trying to knock you out, right? He's not going to be on his back foot behind a jab, circling you, using lateral movement, trying to win rounds with the judges strategically. No, he's going to be on his front foot. He's going to try to overwhelm you. Then he's going to try to drop power shots in. Now, all I'm saying is, understand, you don't have to play chess with the man. That's the point here. You don't have to try to time counters with the man. You can actually lead behind a jab. You can use a jab and movement to touch him, to win rounds, to get out of the way. And all I'm saying is Kovalev is not defensively blessed. Right? If Pascal, who has the hand speed, who has the jab, who has the athleticism, if Pascal can keep this in the middle of the ring, right? If Pascal can study the first Rocky Marciano, Ezzard Charles fight, where Charles goes the distance, a forgotten classic, right? By keeping himself in the middle of the ring and by moving, forcing Marciano to reset, right? Then in my opinion, Pascal has a chance to either outpoint or to land a home run shot on Kovalev, right? Kovalev's going to be hyper-aggressive just like he was when he got caught by Caparello. Right? Why can't Pascal, with quicker hands than Caparello, with a big punch, in both hands, why can't Pascal get lucky and land the shot? So look, I know the public sees first fight KO and thinks, oh, this is going to be more of the same. I'm just here to tell you that, you know, that first fight, don't get me wrong, Kovalev lands big punches, but I thought that first fight stopped prematurely. And I believe at these odds, you want to take Pascal to win the fight. You don't have to take him by KO. They're giving you a plus 950. Just take him to win the fight. Trust me, you're not going to get broke winning plus 950s. Just take Pascal to win the fight. Right? And hedge the play with Kovalev by KO. If Kovalev does what the public thinks he's going to do, then as long as you're getting better than a minus 950 on the Kovalev by KO part of the ledger, you'll do okay. You're hedged. Right? The first fight ended with the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th rounds left to go. If you're that confident that the script from the first fight is going to be the script in the second fight, then you can get Kovalev by KO. My point to you is don't overlook the fact that Pascal is a former light heavyweight champion, right? I feel Pascal here is getting the Miguel Cotto treatment, right? Somehow we're forgetting who the guy is, right? You know, Cotto. First off, I thought Cotto beat Canelo in that last fight. Okay, I know there's one person out there who's going to give me a negative because I said something negative about Canelo. Right, I thought Cotto won that fight. But now I'm reading where people are offering houses and all this other stuff, saying, hey, if they have a rematch, Cotto's going to get killed. I'm like, come on now. Look, you need to realize that when you're dealing with the Cottos, when you're dealing with the Pascals, recognize that you're dealing with someone who has game. Right? Pascal doesn't have to sit there and try to think and play a lot of chess. All he has to do is step out behind a jab and circle Kovalev. Let Kovalev know, look, this party doesn't start until you get by my jab. Right? If Pascal sees Kovalev asleep at the wheel, Pascal has the hand speed to come in and throw flurries. Isn't that what he did in the early rounds against Chad Dawson? Let me just tell you, in terms of pure boxing ability, right? In my opinion, Kovalev's not prime Chad Dawson. Right? He's not. If Pascal comes out and plays it like he did against Chad Dawson, and just remembers that he doesn't have to trade with the slugger, he can keep the slugger outside. He can adopt an ambush strategy. Just come in. You don't have to open up. Just come in, pump a few jabs, right? Have a little reserve punch. If the guy slips a jab, you have a little reminder to him that, hey, I got things other than this jab. Circle it. You know, Wilt Chamberlain figured life out. Chamberlain, a dominant figure, Basketball Hall of Famer, right, said nobody roots for Goliath. Could you imagine what happens if Pascal comes out and wins three or four of the first four rounds? If the crowd senses that this could be a changing of the title night in Canada, right? Pascal's adopted country. Could you imagine that? People will be standing up at the start of the fifth round, right? You might even start hearing chants for Pascal, right? Kovalev's going to start to get desperate. Keep in mind, too, I know his public fight with Bernard Hopkins went 12 rounds, right? Folks, that's the only fight Kovalev has had that's gone 12 rounds. Have we figured that out yet? Right? Hopkins, a master, doesn't have the athleticism of Jean Pascal. He doesn't have Pascal's hand speed and stuff like that. Going 12 rounds with Hopkins might not be as grueling as trying to go 12 rounds with Jean Pascal. And I know I'm going to get a bunch of emails saying, Hopkins beat Pascal. Trust me, I know I picked Hopkins over Pascal. Right? But understand, going 12 rounds with Pascal requires more than going 12 rounds with Bernard Hopkins. How do you know if Pascal comes out with hand speed, and this time a little bit different tactic, rather than trying to stand and trade with a slugger, let's say Pascal is moving around the ring using his athleticism, shooting a jab, keeping Kovalev at distance, right? How do you know if Kovalev senses he's behind in the fifth round, if Kovalev realizes that he's fighting Pascal in Pascal's adopted country and gets desperate, you know, realizes that, wow, the judges might be scoring these rounds for Pascal. How do we know Kovalev is going to stay focused to then empty the gun going for the knockout without depleting his stamina? Without having something left for the championship rounds. So look, I don't know who wins this fight, but I know how I'm going to play it because the casino's given me the blueprint. I walk into a sports book and someone tells me plus 950 on Jean Pascal. I'm walking to the front to place the bet. And as I do so, I'll say, oh, somebody else tell me, who's he fighting? Right? A plus 950 on Jean Pascal, that's a gift, folks. Right? As I said, unless you're getting a minus 1,000 or some huge number on Kovalev by knockout, this bet hedges itself. Right? I like Pascal to win the fight hedged with Kovalev by KO. I'm guessing the casino is going to give you Kovalev by KO at like maybe a minus 600 or something like that. Understand the spread between a minus 600 and a plus 950 is where you're going to make your money on this fight. Let me say this too, to all of those who believe that it's a foregone conclusion that Jean Pascal is going to lie down in this fight. In how many fights has Jean Pascal been caught and stopped? Right? Look that up. The guy has a great chin. I'm telling you, I saw a Pascal fight once, where Pascal, during the fight, had his shoulder pop out. I'm not kidding, right? His shoulder looked all odd and stuff like that. You know what happened? Between rounds, his corner got around him and popped his shoulder back in place, right? Pascal then continued on in the fight and won the fight. That's the kind of warrior we're talking about, right? You know how the last fight ends? Pascal gets hit with some big shots. He's still on his feet. He's not on the canvas being counted out. He's still on his feet, folks. The ref steps in and stops the fight. Right? So, for all of you who think that Pascal's going to come in and lay down, you just don't know Jean Pascal. Right? The casino making this a plus 950. Come on. How many average fighters have you seen in big fights who've gotten shorter odds than this? This is plus 950? Sign me up. I'm convinced. I'll take Pascal. I'll take the bait. I'll take Pascal to win the fight, hedged with Kovalev by KO. Understand, too, the nature of a hedge. If Kovalev gets the KO, I'm not going to be crying. I'll be in line collecting with everyone else. That's why you want to be on both sides of this one. But do understand the risks. If Kovalev comes out, and if Kovalev somehow goes the distance and wins the decision, you lose it all, right? If that happens, don't cry to me about it, because the bottom line is this is gambling, and yep, folks, this is the adult part of the internet. There's risk involved, real risks. Finally, I know I have a group, and I feel blessed having this group of real hardcore boxing fans who remember boxing and who know boxing much better than I do, especially old-timers who, you know, lived through the 50s, 60s, 70s. I'm fully aware of the fact that in the Ezra Charles Rocky Marciano rematch, that Rocky Marciano got the stoppage, right? Just understand, though, that that's the infamous fight where Rocky Marciano gets his nose split open, right, by Ezra Charles. Gets his nose split open. And then, of course, the referee goes over to Marciano's corner and says, Rock, if you don't end the show here, I'm going to end the fight. So, of course, Marciano goes on to end the show. My question to all of those old-timers is, could you imagine getting a plus 950 on Ezra Charles before that second fight? Hey, I would have taken that. Anyway, that's how I see it. Let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. Good luck and be prudent. Thanks for stopping by.